So let's get started. So the talk I'm doing today, the crypto airplane, comes from my love of two technologies. I really, really like computers, communications, blockchains, cryptocurrency, cryptography, all things crypto. I also love aviation. And many of you probably already know this, but I'm an amateur pilot. So I'm a licensed private pilot. I fly small single-engine airplanes, ones that are really smaller than your family car in most respects. And I do this for fun. It's not something I want to do professionally. I do it as a hobby. It's something I started doing when I was 19 years old. I love aviation. I love the methodical aspect of trying to figure out how this incredible machine works. I love the feeling of being in the sky and being in control. I love the sense of accomplishment that comes from being able to master a skill like that. Many of the same things I love about crypto. So I often find parallels in topics that I'm interested in. And today's talk, the crypto airplane, is about the parallels I see between aviation and cryptocurrencies. In fact, what I'm going to do is create an elaborate scenario, an analogy. And this analogy will be used to highlight some very, very important concepts that I think we all need to understand. Now, over the last few months, we've been accelerating down the runway with this crypto airplane. So let's talk about how we got here, what's happening, and how we see some similarities between aviation and cryptocurrency. So the first thing I want to talk about is the idea that there are different classes of ownership in cryptocurrencies. Not everyone who owns cryptocurrency owns it at the same level. Think about aviation, right? When you get into a commercial flight, maybe you are in first class, maybe you're in business class, maybe you're in economy, maybe you're in basic economy, or maybe you're flying standby. So you have a ticket, but you don't yet have a seat allocated. And if you look at cryptocurrency ownership from the same perspective, there are different levels of cryptocurrency ownership. So let's look at some of these levels and see what they mean. One of the reasons there's a lot of excitement about cryptocurrency is the announcement of some big financial institutions that they have now entered the cryptocurrency space. Specifically, PayPal announced a few months back that they would now make Bitcoin available to their customers, and their customers can buy and sell Bitcoin. If you looked at the fine print, you would have noticed something peculiar, and that is that you cannot withdraw your Bitcoin. So there is no mechanism to actually take custody of Bitcoin once you've bought it from PayPal. And this is not just PayPal that does this. We see the same pattern with companies like Robinhood, which is a broker trader for stocks. And in that case, again, you can buy and you can sell, but you can't withdraw. Long before either of these two companies were available to retail investors, another company called Grayscale Investments that has an index fund called GBTC offered a way to be exposed to the price of crypto for accredited investors, where you could buy and sell GBTC shares, and you have a share in a trust that owns Bitcoin, and the share value represents the price of the underlying asset, Bitcoin in this case, that is held in trust for you as it fluctuates. So again, you get price exposure. Now, again, you can't withdraw the Bitcoin. So you never have real control over the Bitcoin. All you're getting is price exposure. And I really compare that directly to having a ticket to fly, but you're flying standby. There isn't actually a seat allocated to you on the aircraft. Maybe you're going to fly. Maybe you're not going to fly. So if PayPal and Robinhood and GBTC is flying standby, then it would kind of make sense that the next level up is an economy class ticket that has an assigned seat. And that would be something like your Coinbase, Gemini, Kraken, or whatever other exchange you're using where you've bought some Bitcoin. And if you wish, you can withdraw it. And withdrawing it essentially means you give the exchange a Bitcoin address and you transfer that Bitcoin from the custody of the exchange to self-custody, to keys that you control, thereby achieving one of the most important principles in the cryptocurrency space, which I've immortalized in a slogan and also turned into a mug. None of you are surprised at this point. You've seen this mug many times. Not your keys, not your coins. Cheers to that. So if you buy from an exchange that allows you withdrawal, you're an economy. But you really don't yet have self-custody, because if you just leave the cryptocurrency on the exchange, they have control of the keys. And a lot of things can go wrong when they have control of the keys. You may discover, for example, that in the end, they didn't have your Bitcoin, or it got stolen, or it got frozen, or it got lost due to embezzlement, or the government seized it, or your account got shut down due to suspicious activity that they won't tell you what that is, etc., etc. And then comes the next step, and that's business class. Business class is where you have custody of your cryptocurrency. And business class is a pretty big upgrade. Now, here, you are in control of your destiny. You have the keys, and therefore you can exert full control over that cryptocurrency. It can't be taken from you, it can't be seized, frozen, it can't be embezzled. And if you take good care of your keys, it's actually very difficult to steal it from you because you have decentralized security. Someone has to go out and rob everyone who has these keys rather than having a nice, juicy honeypot in the form of a centralized exchange. So, business class, that's where things start getting interesting. Now, there may be some additional classes available. On many flights, business class is it. It's the best you can get. On some classes, on some flights, they might have first class. So, what would be first class? Well, maybe first class is not only do you have custody of your own keys, but you also earned that Bitcoin instead of buying it on an exchange, and you're running your own node. So that would be another upgrade. It's not a huge difference from business class. You are still a custodian of your own destiny with the keys. You have an assigned seat if you want, and it's a nice one too, with lots of legroom. But it's a slight upgrade, sometimes a quite nice upgrade. The big difference, of course, between simply having self-custody and earning your crypto through products and services that you offer, or getting it on a decentralized exchange and running your own node, is privacy. You see, one of the important things about first class is there's a little curtain that closes that keeps all of them people out in the back away from the luxuries that you're enjoying in first class. Now, the funny thing about that is that what that means is the people who've never actually flown first class don't know what it involves. The same with business class, because there's another little curtain, and they don't really see the point. Maybe they notice that you boarded earlier. Maybe as they're walking down the aisle, they notice that you've been offered a newspaper, maybe some champagne in a little plastic glass, some orange juice. But, you know, the seat's slightly nicer, but is it really worth a ticket that's four times more expensive? It doesn't seem to be like that. Which reminds me of a friend of mine who had never flown in business or first class. And we went on a trip to New Zealand. And during this flight, they had the first time opportunity to experience not only first class, but first class in Asian airline, or in this case, New Zealand airline, and first class on a long, long flight. And trust me, this is a whole other level of first class. Now, at first, it looks kind of the same. Only instead of the seat simply laying flat, in this particular flight, the seat flipped over and revealed a hard bottom side of the seat that was flat as a bed, onto which a mattress was unrolled, followed by a featherbed duvet. When the flight attendant came by, they almost offered to tuck you in. So it's a whole other experience. And of course, the people in the back didn't get to see any of that because there was a curtain. It's a bit difficult to explain how much of a different experience it is to be able to order your meals anytime you want, watch a movie from a huge catalog, maybe sleep, take a nap, wake up again, order a snack off the menu, get served breakfast at whatever time you want, and then arrive at your destination fresh. But of course, the ticket is quite expensive. Here's the thing though. The one thing that's very different about crypto is that the difference between flying standby and flying first class is not an issue of money. It's purely an issue of education and skill. In a traditional airline, in order to upgrade yourself from economy to first class, you have to pay a lot of money. But in crypto, in the blockchain space, when you're dealing with Bitcoin or Ethereum or one of these other technologies, the upgrade is simply a matter of learning. If you know nothing, you're very likely to buy a standby ticket from PayPal or Robinhood and not know that all you're getting is the price. Not know that if you actually control your own keys, you can do a lot more. And not knowing that there is a series of steps for self-custody that will give you more and more control. And the only difference between the people sitting in first class and the people sitting in economy is that the people in first class have spent a couple of years studying and building skills in order to be able to get there. So that's the big difference. You don't get to buy your better seat. You get to teach yourself a better class of Bitcoin ownership or Ethereum ownership or generally cryptocurrency ownership simply through education and building skills. Here's the other thing though. There's more to this flight that meets the eye. For many people, this is simply a matter of going to some destination. But there are these people who have predicted that the city we are departing from is about to experience the 1,000-year flood. And they're desperate to get the hell out. And so for them, this ticket represents exit from a disaster scenario that's unfolding. You get to see these particular passengers. Many of them are crowded in business and first class. Yeah, they might be wearing animal pelts, carrying MREs, and trying to get their guns on board. They seem very, very paranoid and edgy, and they keep telling other people that if they don't get on this plane, they're going to see their city wiped out by this flood. And it's really funny because you can't really explain that to the other people who are maybe just going on a vacation. Imagine the conversation of these newbies who are going on vacation. A nice family from Minnesota. John, those people out front, they seem rather strange. Eh? Yes. They kept talking about a big flood. Yeah, I know. Oofta. It's the kind of thing that happened to my cousin Marge in Argentina. They keep having floods all the time. Do you think we're gonna have a flood? Let's just enjoy our vacation, folks. You can't explain what's happening to people who are there just to get a tourist vacation. Now, then of course, there's those of us who didn't board this aircraft because we're trying to run away from a flood. Mainly, The aviation enthusiasts. I'm into the technology. I love building and tinkering and flying, and I'm just fascinated by everything aviation. Even before I got on a flight, I had studied everything about every aircraft. I devoured information about aviation long before I got to do my first flight as a pilot, even a student pilot. And of course, the exhilaration of flying solo for the first time, which is terrifying, and then flying with passengers who are my responsibility and doing long distance flights, et cetera, et cetera. It's a whole journey. And I don't do it because I'm trying to get somewhere. The purpose of aviation for me isn't to get from A to B. I'm not commuting to the office. I do it because of the love of flying. And even in crypto, there are those who are crypto enthusiasts, who just are in it for the technology, love the technology. And maybe there's going to be a flood. And certainly if there is a flood coming, I want to be able to get out of Dodge. And sure, it helps that I have access to an aircraft that I can rent. You know, maybe I go on the commercial flight, but I also have access to a little single engine four-seater that I can use to get out of Dodge, and I know how to operate it. So worst comes to worst, I might do that. Some of the enthusiasts, of course, are buying their own planes. Think of this as the hardware wallet scenario. And there's all kinds of arguments about whether a Cessna is better than a Piper, or a Piper is better than a carbon fiber Cub that can do a very short takeoff and landing and land on the gravel bed next to a river in Alaska. That's the cold card if you didn't get it so far. You know, what's the difference between a Piper, might be a Trezor, a Cessna, might be the Ledger, or some other hardware wallet? There's dozens of different models. Really, the biggest difference is that you've decided to take absolute control of that mechanism, and you're willing to maintain and run the device and have ultimate control and custody over your keys. So, well, buying a hardware wallet is probably a good idea, and having one is better than not having one at all. Really, the differences between the different models are not as substantial as the difference between flying commercial or not flying at all. And then, of course, even the people in standby, the people who have tickets but not seats, they're also at least interested in leaving the flood zone. They haven't yet figured out that in order to leave the flood zone, you have to get a seat. And they also haven't figured out that they're in a very precarious position. Flying standby doesn't always end well. And one of the reasons it doesn't always end well is because the airlines tend to oversell the seats. This is known as fractional reserve aviation. Well, no, it isn't, but it should be. So you arrive at the airport, the waters are rising back in the security zone, they're up to your ankle already, and you really, really want to get onto this plane when suddenly you hear, ladies and gentlemen, could I have your attention, please? At this moment, our flight is oversold. We are looking for volunteers to take the next flight, which is also overbooked, or perhaps the one after that, in order to free up some space. But do not worry. Those of you who have a ticket are going to be offered a Fiat voucher of $112, as well as a voucher for the Holiday Inn Express, and this wonderful set of PayPal-branded floaties that you can wear to remain dry somewhat from the neck up while you wave at the aircraft departing from this airport. So, clearly, standby is pretty risky. If you don't have custody of your keys and you don't know that the Bitcoin actually exists, or even if it does exist when you bought it, how secure is that? You're one executive order or legislative action before PayPal has to shut down all trading and turn over the Bitcoin to the government because it's now being considered an illegal asset. And maybe they'll fight that. I'm sure they will. And one Supreme Court decision later, boom, there goes your Bitcoin. They will compensate you. They will compensate you in worthless fiat, which is about the same as getting floaties to escape a flood while watching other people board the crypto airplane. Now, if you're on the plane and you see the people in the gate who are on standby, you have one of two options. You can mock them, or you can help them get a seat. And I've always believed it's more important to help others to get upgraded in their skills and education so they can also get a seat on the crypto airplane, or maybe even build some more airplanes. There's lots of ways to do that, but don't forget that even the people who just bought a ticket and don't have a seat, they're fueling this aircraft. Their money is paying for part of your flight, even if they don't end up flying. So, first of all, thank you. Secondly, being at the airport is already a huge step up. All of the people who are sitting at home going, there's no flood, the flood is a hoax. It was a hoax to make us think we need to fly out of here. The water rising, that's just a seasonal event. I'm sure the waters will recede again. What's on TV, honey? Those people haven't even arrived at the airport yet. At least the people with standby tickets have figured out that maybe it's a good idea to try to get on a flight. And they're certainly funding your efforts. Then again, of course, there's all of the people who are just noticing that airline stocks are shooting through the roof, and there's a secondary market for standby tickets that are being traded furiously by people sitting at home calling their broker and their travel agency. Travel agent is making lots and lots and lots of money selling and reselling and reselling these standby tickets and creating a mania around it. But keep in mind, they're not actually getting out of the flood zone. All they're doing is making money that they can't actually spend because it's going to be sitting underwater. So understanding these nuances allows you to gradually see what we're trying to do. There is a chance that this is just a seasonal flood. We have to accept the reality that maybe the waters will recede and all that will happen is some damage to the basement and ground floor, you know, the lower classes. They'll get sunk. But hey, if you have a condo in the sky with some nice investments and, you know, you can barricade your door so the people from the basement don't try to raid your apartment, maybe everything's going to be fine. But there's also the possibility that this really is a pretty nasty flood. And at that point, you're better off having at least one ticket, or even better, a seat, or even better, an airplane and a pilot's license. You don't want to find out at the end of the day that you should have taken some precautions up front. So the bottom line here is that ownership in crypto has different levels. And there is one very big distinction between flying standby, flying economy, and flying in business class where you control your own keys. That difference can be a life-saving difference. And it's not just Bitcoin we're talking about. In fact, in some other cryptocurrencies, the difference is even greater. Think, for example, what the difference is between owning an index fund that exposes you to the price of Ethereum that you can't use to do any of the interesting smart contract things. You can't use it for DeFi, you can't use it for tokens, you can't really use it at all. All you get is exposure to the price versus controlling your own keys that you can use to do some interesting things with smart contracts. For Ethereum, the difference is night and day. And that difference means that as we see more and more controls on exchanges and things like that, owning custodial Ethereum that you don't control the keys becomes more and more meaningless. In a utility token like Ethereum, if you take away the utility, you're not left with much. So the bottom line is that whether you are one of the crazy preppers with the pelts and the MREs crowding out business class or building your own planes, whether you are one of the people who just has a love of aviation, maybe you're one of the people in economy class who's gotten a taste for this and is trying to graduate to the next level. Maybe you're one of those people who is trying to build a kit at home. Be careful, of course, because not all kits are the same. And if you exceed your skill level, you might end up building something that isn't very airworthy. This, for example, would be the case if you're trying to build a hardware wallet out of consumer equipment and a general purpose operating system. Allow me to demonstrate. I have a hardware wallet. This is going to be awesome. Oops. The bottom line is, no matter what your level of skill and education, you're welcome. We will get out of here. This flight will depart on time. And if all we're doing is going for a quick little jaunt, a little vacation, that's fine. And if, in fact, the 1,000-year flood is about to completely wipe out the city we're leaving from, you'll be very glad you got on to the crypto airplane. Now that you're here, help the people in the seats behind you get educated and get upgraded in their skills. That's all I had for you today. Thanks so much for listening to this talk about the crypto airplane. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any comments, questions, or suggestions, please leave them in the video comments below. And don't forget to subscribe and share this video if you enjoyed it. Thanks so much for listening.
Hi, I'm Andreas Antonopoulos. If you enjoyed that video, consider that it takes a lot of work to produce open and free content that can be shared with everyone around the world. This isn't sponsored by some company. It's not promoting a product or an altcoin or some kind of investment scheme. My goal is simply to help explain the technology of Bitcoin and open blockchains to as many people as possible in a neutral way that focuses really on the incredible possibilities that this technology brings us. If you'd like to support that mission, subscribe to my channel and go on patreon.com/aantonop, where you can participate and help me build better content for more people. Thank you.